morning, people. I hope you're doing well, my lovely, so let me show you this. Though I warn you, it may contain science. And puppies! In the 36 years since the Chernobyl accident, the immediate area of the Chernobyl Exclusion Zone has been far from an ecological dead zone. Despite the high concentrations of cesium-137, iodine-131, and other radionucleotides that took a hit on local nature, some species have recovered. Maybe because there are fewer humans there to bother them. We don't know whether they're the descendants of pets from evacuated individuals or free-roaming dogs that settled in the area, but for decades there have been a whole population of dogs in the CEZ, as many as 800 at one point. They're fed by cleanup workers and CEZ tourists. I guess everywhere can have tourism. And some of the dogs even live in the power plant itself. A few years ago, the Chernobyl Dog Research Initiative even established 3 vet clinics in the area to care for these local pupsters. And while caring for their patients, the clinics took blood samples from 302 dogs for scientific use, including in this paper, published in Scientific Advances earlier this year, to answer the only real question worth asking: have the dogs of Chernobyl become superheroes? To figure that out, let's back up. We've heard radiation causes mutations, but what does radiation actually do to your DNA? The mechanics of ionizing radiation on biomatter have been painstakingly researched, given that we use it for x-rays, radiation treatments, so on. Particulate radiation, and a fair amount of that is in the CEZ, either directly ionizes or excites electrons, while electromagnetic radiation transfers its energy into an electron in a way that ejects it from the atom, and all of these destabilize the chemical structures involved. Radiation can affect any molecule in the cell. It's just that DNA gets the most attention because DNA damage to even a single gene may be enough to kill or significantly change a cell, especially when a dividing cell attempts to replicate. We take DNA damage throughout our lives, and we actually have a bunch of mechanisms in place to repair and do cleanup where needed. Eventually, the damage does build up and take its toll, and that's one of the mechanisms by which our bodies age. Our typical DNA damage tends to be single strands or cluster damage, whereas radiation can also often break both strands of your DNA, snapping it in half, well beyond the pay grade of our repair technicians. Some genes happen to have chemical structures that make them more or less resilient to radiation, but each cell that takes damage from radiation will break somewhere different. That's why when you get hit with radiation, you don't turn into a superhero. It's not like all your cells are changed at the same specific point in the genome in a way that would produce a consistent mutation. So, even if a single cell somehow took damage in a way that produced a groovy mutation, that doesn't mean other cells did. So eventually that one little cool cell turns over and we never notice a physiological difference. More commonly, when hit with radiation, some cells become neoplastic, while a bunch of your cells stop being able to divide properly either because they fall over when they try to do it, or because those cells go into senescence and refuse to divide as a protective mechanism so they don't do it wrong and become problem cells. By contrast, when you reproduce, you ultimately only provide a single haploid cell, so if that cell happens to have a mutation from all this, it gets passed on. So what I'm saying is, radiation doesn't turn you into a superhero, but there's hope for your kid. Of course, it's more likely that your kid becomes extremely bendy and bad at bipedalism because, hey, you're kind of playing with RNG here, and in fact, it's entirely possible your haploid cells got too messed up to allow for reproduction due to that radiation, which is a known consequence of ionizing radiation, same as with any other cell. Typically, though, we study higher doses of radiation and/or shorter timeframes. The animals of Chernobyl provide a unique natural experiment to study long-term, low-dose radiation. Previous studies have shown that other mammals, like specifically bank voles from the CEZ, have cells with increased resistance against stress from DNA damage and oxidation, but that could be the product of changes in gene expression, rather than the product of mutation. Gene expression is about how much flour do I put in this brownie recipe and when do I put the flour in, whereas mutation is substituting wheat flour for rice flour. So, do our dogs of Chernobyl run on metaphorical rice flour? What were the results of our whole genome analysis? Well, the dogs of the Chernobyl nuclear power plant area are genetically distinct from free-roaming dogs in Chernobyl City and in Slavutyesh in Belarus, which are 15 and 45 kilometers from the Chernobyl nuclear power plant, respectively. That said, some dogs from the Chernobyl nuclear power plant area were related to city and Slavutyesh dogs, suggesting that there may be some admixture between these groups of free-breeding dogs, or that there were relatives in these locations before the power plant pups became a distinct population. There are very few dogs in the power plant group with relatives from a dog population outside Ukraine, though, whereas city dogs have a handful of non-local purebreds in their population genetics. Within the fairly isolated population of the power plant pups, there are large, distinct, multi-generational families. For instance, 10 of the 14 dogs from one testing location belong to the same family network. Taken together, these data suggest that although there is some interaction with dogs outside the CEZ, most of these dogs have been in the general area for a long time, rather than dogs from outside the area continually moving in and cycling the population. That suggests we are looking at a good population to study the long-term effects of cumulative DNA damage, as well as ascertain possible genetic variants. But just because these dogs are genetically distinct from the surrounding local populations does not mean that radiation is responsible for that distinctiveness or even for any genetic variants we may find. This is a relatively isolated population, a Ukrainian Galapagos, which has its own effects on genetic distinctiveness. This study focuses on kinship analyses, breed-derived haplotype, and population genetics. That's because until we understand the population dynamics of the dogs of Chernobyl, we won't necessarily be able to tell radiation-related genetic variants from inbreeding effects. And while the presence of radiation may change the mutation rate, it's not necessarily the case that radiation-induced mutation will be responsible for any given variant. Selective pressure also plays a role. If we see dogs with variants in genes associated with DNA repair, that's a trait that confers survival benefit and may have preceded the mutation itself. It may be the product of random mutation from radiation, but it may be from some random Pomeranian mix that wandered into the power plant. Certainly, there do seem to be some genetic variations among animals more broadly in the CEZ that seem to confer radiation-related benefits. Eastern tree frogs, which are usually green, are black within the CEZ, and that's thought to be a melanin variation that helps ionize local radiation and protect the little frogster. But it's also possible that the dogs of Chernobyl's adaptations, if they have them, are primarily epigenetic. I mean, brownies taste real different when you use a different amount of flour, even if your genome recipe still uses wheat flour. But questions like these are for future genome-wide association studies. Right now, at most, we can say we have no conclusive evidence that radiation is driving this population of dogs' genetic distinctiveness, and we have no data at all about their gene expression compared to the local dog populations in Chernobyl City or Slavutych. And here's the thing I take from this. This study tells us that the dogs of Chernobyl are growing up and having puppies and building multi-generational families, and by at least that mark, are successful at being dogs. As much as we have to learn about long-term low-dose radiation exposure and how large-bodied mammals like dogs respond to that environment, this study indicates that, at least at the most basic level, the dogs are all right. And maybe superheroes. We'll see.